even though you have terms like sin x and e power x, because you have a linear relation between y double dash and y. And for the same reason, the second one is a nonlinear equation. So you, if you are able to write an in explicit form of this relation, you have an nth order differential equation that you find in the equation 2. Now, you will find that most of the study that we find in these textbooks are often about first order systems of equations, you know, initial value problems and so on. Even if you look at the numerical analysis, the Runge-Kutta methods and such methods are often given for first order initial value problems. The reason is any nth order differential equation, ordinary differential equation, can be reduced to a system of n first order differential equations. So for instance, if you write y, if you call y as y1, y dash is y2, and the n minus 1 derivative as yn, then this nth order differential equation in 2 is equivalent to a system of n first order differential equations, which is actually a very general, which is actually a special case of a more general form, which you find here. So here is a system of n first order differential equations for y1, y2, yn. And these systems of differential equations occur in many instances in nature. And we actually, in dynamical systems, we say it's a system having n degrees of. Now, what is it about these differential equations that is interesting is that very more often than not, it is a formidable task to find a solution in a reasonably simple form when the differential equation is nonlinear. You know that we have an elaborate theory for linear equations. There are methods to find the solutions for linear equations, linear differential equations, I mean. And we do not have such a corresponding theory for nonlinear differential equations, ordinary differential equations. For instance, there are some ad hoc methods and all that, but we need not lose heart because a wealth of important information can still be obtained qualitatively, even if we are not able to actually solve these equations. And these methods are more often than not geometrical in nature, and then these methods are actually employed to analyze the solutions, and we get some important information from this sort of an analysis. So I think I'm just going to skip all these things so that we can quickly go to the applications. So I'll just tell you what actually I had on these slides. So here, if you've seen equation, you know, this system 3, it's actually showing you a system of two first order equations in two unknowns, which is actually what is called as a non-homogeneous system due to the presence of these two functions f1 and f2. And we assume that these functions a11, a12, a21, a22, these are continuous, and also f1 and f2 on the interval ab where t lies, so that we are sure of the existence of the solutions of this system of equations. So if these f1, f2 are zero, then we call it to be a homogeneous system of equations. So any solution, x is equal to x of t, y is equal to y of t. So this is said to be, any x is equal to x of t, there's a mistake here, this y shouldn't have been there, and y is equal to y of t, such that x and y have continuous derivatives on AB, and satisfying the equations 3 identically in the interval AB, said to be a solution of this system 3. So, I'll just skip this theorem on the fundamental existence and uniqueness theorem. Most of you must be familiar. So, this is a homogeneous linear system in for two variables. And this is another theorem which says that if I have two solutions, x1, y1, and x2, y2, for this system of homogeneous equations, any linear combination of this homogeneous system is also a solution. And then this slide was about the linear dependence and independence of two solutions. So two solutions are said to be linearly dependent if we can find constant C1, C2, not both zeros, such that these two equations are satisfied. Otherwise, they are said to be linearly independent. Okay, so I'll also go through this quickly. So this is an important theorem which says that there exists sets of two linearly independent solutions of the homogeneous linear system, four, and every solution of the system can be written as a linear combination of two linearly independent solutions of four. So this, the solution that I have written here is called as a general solution of this homogeneous system of equations. So in fact, the two solutions are linearly independent on an interval AB if and only if the Wronskian is different from zero for all t, for t lying between A and B. And then there is another theorem that says that the Wronskian of two solutions of the system is either identically zero or never zero for all t, for t lying between AB. And if two solutions x1y1, x2y2, which are linearly independent on AB, and if xp/y3 is any particular solution of the non-homogeneous system, then a general solution of this non-homogeneous system can be written in this form. So since you may be familiar with all these things, I'll just skip these things and go on to the topic of discussion. So here, you may be familiar with this as well. I wanted to recall this for you, where if I have a system of equations with constant coefficients, then we can find the solution for this through what is called as a characteristic equation or auxiliary equation, and depending on the nature of the roots, we can write the solution. So I think we can skip this one as well. So okay, so let me come to the applications of the differential equations that some of us are already familiar with. We all know that in medicine, differential equations are used to model cancer growth or spread of disease. In engineering, we use differential equations to describe the movement of electricity. In chemistry, we use them to model chemical reactions. In economics, we use them to find the optimum investment strategies. And in physics, we have seen that we use the differential equations to describe motion of waves, pendulums, and so on. Now, all of us today, if you notice, we are having this meeting because of a very important thing, horrendous epidemic that's going on around us, and that is the COVID-19. Much before this, there have been other epidemics like the Ebola virus, which have caused more fear than any other disease in recent times. Now, how a disease will spread, how can you take measures to prevent it, and so on, are very important issues for us to consider. So the epidemiologists are on this job with the help, that is actually something that they would be interested in handling. Because when this disease starts getting out of control, it affects the entire world in more ways than one. The economy gets disrupted, and it can lead to a lot of situations which are totally uncontrolled. So this is a situation where mathematicians play a very vital role in stopping the epidemic. Now, a very important set of differential equations called the SIR equations have been used by mathematicians. They are a simple set of equations which were developed in the 1920s, and they actually model and tell us what will happen over a period of time. So you might have seen on YouTube an Oxford mathematician explaining what is called as an SIR model. So this actually is a very primitive model to explain the spread of the coronavirus, for instance. S stands for susceptible, I for infected, and R for recovered, or even removed. That is the population that has recovered or developed immunity. They are not being considered. So these three states indicate I mean SIR are three possible states of the members of the population which is affected by a contagious disease. Now, this SIR model was developed by Ronald Ross. We are all familiar with his name because he is associated with the disease called malaria. And he and some others in the early 20th century discussed this SIR model, which consists of a system of three coupled nonlinear ordinary differential equations and may not possess an explicit formula solution. So a very often heard model in the context of SIR models is the Kermack-McKendrick model, and it is a model that is used to discuss the infectious diseases associated with contagious illnesses for a number of people in a close population over some time. And this actually was used to study the epidemics such as plague and cholera. And this model actually consists of three coupled nonlinear differential equations, ordinary differential equations, which you will find here in 1, 2, and 3. So here T is time, S is the number of susceptible people, I is the number of infected people, and R is the number of people who have recovered and developed immunity to the infection, beta is the infection rate, and gamma is the recovery rate. Now, as I mentioned, this is a very primitive model, and there have been other variations of this, like SIER. So, S is susceptible, I is infected, E is, I think, exposed, R is recovered or removed or whatever. And then there have been many variations of that. In fact, if you look at the recent literature that deals with the coronavirus, you will find that there are a host of models which are using ordinary differential equations, partial differential equations, and sometimes even fractional differential equations. But I'm not presenting those because I just really wanted to present a very simple model for you. And then another area of, another application of differential equations you will find in population dynamics. I will just dwell on this a little bit today. One of the species which are studied here in the early times is the population of herbivores and carnivores like rabbits and foxes, which live in a close forest, and this back and forth existence between the predators and prey, which are perpetually locked in a cycle of growth and contraction, they are modeled by the help of some nonlinear differential equations. I will come back to this in a short while. Okay, another area where the differential equations are applied, you will be surprised to know, is in plastic surgery. So what do plastic surgeons do? They perform skin grafts by identifying a healthy region of, a region of healthy skin, and they carefully remove it along with the key arteries and veins and create what is called as a surgical flap. So what is important is to preserve the flow of blood so that the oxygen continues to reach the tissue. So in this kind of circumstances, in the US, for instance, a team of mathematicians and surgeons have attempted to find, a model which is with a set of differential equations so that they can create a surgical flap so that the required blood flow is sustained. And of course, in rockets and satellites, we have seen how mathematicians play a very important role. In fact, for the launch of rockets and satellites, we need the differential equations as well as spherical geometry. Of course, for the scientists to have communication with the satellites, as you have seen in the case of Chandrayaan, prevent the noise and get the appropriate data which is reliable. Mathematicians also use some very important and clever algorithms to encode this data. But okay, that's a different subject altogether. But certainly, differential equations are playing a very vital role in the launch of rockets and satellites. Then, in weather prediction, you will see that, for instance, fluids like the atmosphere, they follow a complicated set of partial differential equations. They are governed by partial differential equations called the Navier-Stokes equations, which are highly nonlinear in nature. And unfortunately, we still do not know a direct solution for these equations. It's one of the greatest unsolved problems in mathematics. And it also happens to be one of the Millennium Prize problems announced by the Clay Mathematics Institute, carrying with it a prize of $1 million. So, as I mentioned before, I will talk about this pre-predator equations a little bit, and then move on to how this model has helped us to, you know, study some other problems which you may not even believe would be related to the population of foxes and rabbits. So here we are discussing in this topic a nonlinear system of equations, which is an example of an ecological situation involving two species, one preying on the other. This is actually an representation of the eternal problem of struggle for survival among different species living in the same environment. So you have a close forest inhabited by foxes and rabbits. Now, what do the rabbits live on? They live on the vegetation in the forest, and the foxes eat in turn these rabbits. Initially, what happens is there is an abundant supply of food for the rabbits, and then therefore there are abundant rabbits for the foxes to prey on. Then what happens is, because of the abundant food, the foxes increase in number, they become too many in number, and then they eat too many rabbits, and suddenly there will be a period of famine for them because there are no more enough rabbits for the foxes to eat, and then their population starts declining. Now, as the foxes reduce in number, there is less threat for the population of rabbits, and then their population thrives. So once the rabbit population thrives, now again there is enough food for the foxes. So this in turn increases the fox population, and thus there will be an endless cycle of increases and decreases in the population of the two species, which is thus interrelated. So here this is a representation of the increase and decrease in the fox and rabbit populations. So this is rabbit's population is depicted by this dotted lines, and the fox population, sorry, this is the fox's population, and this is the rabbit population that is given by this. So let's model this mathematically. Suppose I call the population of foxes and rabbits, what I mean is, suppose x of t represents the population of rabbits at time t, and y of t represents the population of foxes at time t. Now, in the absence of the foxes, that is the predators, the growth of the rabbits can be represented by this equation, dx dt is equal to ax. Obviously, a will be positive because the rabbit population will thrive in the absence of foxes, and a is called the growth rate of prey. In the absence of the prey, the foxes die out. That is, dy dt is equal to minus cy, where c is positive. And c is called the death rate of the predator. Now, what happens is that, first of all, we make these assumptions so that, we are able to formulate the situation mathematically in the simplest way possible. We make a further assumption that the number of encounters between them per unit time is proportional to xy. For instance, if the number of rabbits is doubled, the number of their encounters would be doubled. Now, what happens is that in every encounter, the rabbits are being eaten. So, in the presence of the foxes, the mathematical equations will have to be rewritten, and therefore we assume that dx dt will be equal to ax minus bxy. So we introduce this term minus bxy because every encounter is resulting in a rabbit being eaten, and therefore we actually introduce this term with a minus sign because the encounter xy is going to result in the death of the rabbits. So In the same way, dy dt, which was assumed to be minus cy in the absence of rabbits, is actually going to be dy dt is equal to minus cy plus dxy. We assume that dy dt is of this form with c and d being positive, which is actually a nonlinear system describing their interaction. So here is a system of two equations in two unknowns which are nonlinear, and this actually describes the interaction of the foxes and rabbits and how their populations are affected. These equations are called the Volterra's prey predator equations. Now this solution can be analyzed by considering the parametric equations x is equal to x of t, y is equal to y of t, eliminating t and separating the variables. Now if we do that, what we find is that we end up with this equation, and this k is actually a constant that depends on the initial values. That is, if I assume that at initial time t naught, the population of x is x naught, and that is the population of rabbits is x naught, and if I assume that the population of foxes at time t naught is y naught, then k can be written in terms of x naught, y naught, a, b, c and d in this form. Now we cannot actually solve the above equation for either x or y as a function of t, but we will be able to infer something very important from this equation by following a method suggested by Volterra to analyze the situation. So I'll show you what Volterra inferred from this. So this, you will let me explain what this portrait is. This is a plot of the curves c1 and c2 of the functions. Yes, please. Someone has raised a hand.
No problem, ma'am. Please continue.
Okay. So suppose we plot these curves. So first, let me call this left hand side as z, and let me call the right hand side as w. Okay. So that means z is this quantity and y w is this. So what I will do is I'll represent in the first quadrant. This is the x-axis. This is the y-axis. And this is the z-axis and this is the w-axis. So, and also please notice this line L, which is the line z is equal to w in the third quadrant. Now, if you look at the yz plane, this is the plot of this curve. Z is equal to y to the power of a e to the power of minus b1. And if you look at the fourth quadrant, you will find that this curve is the plot of w is equal to k x to the power of minus c e to the power of dx. Now, what will I be able to infer from these curves? Now, let's look at this point A. In the yz plane, this represents the maximum value of z given on this curve, which I call c1. Now, from here, if I go on to this line z is equal to w, you reach this point M, and from here, if I go on to this quadrant, I will find these two points A dash and A double dash, which represent the bounds for X, like this. So these, so from A, I have come to M, and from M, I have reached the points A dash and A double dash on C2. This is the curve C2. And these points determine the bounds in which x may vary here and here. Similarly, if I look at this this plane, that is the xw plane, then b represents the minimum value of w given by this point. And if I go from here to this line z is equal to w, I reach the point n. And from here, if I go to this quadrant, I will find the points B dash and B double dash on this curve C1, through which I can found the bounds here along which y will, the bounds for y on this curve C1. So from here, I go here, and from here, I find these two points B dash, B double dash, and therefore I find the bounds for y by going along these two lines from B dash and B double. So we can find points P1 and P2, Q1 and Q2 on this curve C3. And if I take any other point R between M and N here on along this line, and by projecting up here up to C1 and then on to C3, I can, and later from R, if I can go to the curve C2 and then on to C3, I can find additional points, you know, that constitute this curve in the first quadrant C1. So by changing the points B results in expanding or contracting the curve C3, which can be done by changing the values of K. Different values of K will give rise to different family of ovals about the point S, which is a degenerate case when the minimum value of W equals to the maximum value of Z. Now, we can also show that any point on this curve moves in an anticlockwise direction. Now let's look at the coordinates of S, which is given by x is equal to c by d and y is equal to a by b. Now, if you look at the system of equations, you will find that c by d and a by b and 0, 0, of course, these are the critical points. And therefore, of course, the point 0, 0 is not of interest to us, so we'll concentrate on the point C by D and A by B. And if I want to see in what direction this is a point on this curve will be moving, let me look at the points X which are less than C by D. That means they're to the left of this point. Now, it follows that when X is less than C by D, dy dt is negative. So that just takes a simple calculation here in this. If you put x is equal to c by d, you will find that dy dt is negative, which means that y is decreasing, and therefore the point on c3 moves along the curve, along the arc q1, q2, p1, q1, like this. And for the same reason, if I take x greater than c by d, you will find that dy dt is positive. Therefore, y will be increasing in this region. So the point will move from q2 to p2 and then q1 like this. So you can see from these two that the point moves on c3 in an anticlockwise direction. So this point actually is an equilibrium point, and these populations are called equilibrium populations when x and y can maintain themselves at constant level. Now, if I look at the more general case where I consider a small deviations from these equilibrium values, that is, I take x as c by d plus some capital X, and if I take y as a by b plus some capital Y, then if I write down the new equations in terms of capital X and capital Y, I find again nonlinear differential equations like this, a system of nonlinear differential equations. But since we are assuming that these are small deviations from the equilibrium values, that is, we assume that X and Y are small, so XY can be neglected, and then these equations can thus be linearized. And if we linearize these equations, we can easily, integrate and find that it has a solution of this form, which is actually the equation of an ellipse. So it's a closed curve. So this actually gives a family of ellipses about the origin in the capital X, capital Y plane, which are like ovals in the figure, and the approximation is reasonable. So this problem actually has been studied as a motivation to study nonlinear systems in great detail. From this analysis, we feel that for studying the nonlinear systems by approximating with linear systems and focusing our attention on the behavior of solutions at which dx, dt, and dy, dt vanish, is important. Now, so these are some of the different ovals that we get by changing k and all those parameters. Now, why was this model actually studied? The genesis for this model was actually a question posed by an Italian biologist to a mathematician. What actually happened in 1926 was there was this Italian biologist by name D'Ancona, who made a statistical study of the changing populations of various species of fish in the Upper Adriatic Sea that surrounds the Italian coast. And this study was over the time span 1910 to 1923. And as luck would have it, it coincided with the World War I, which took place between 1914 and 1918. And what he observed was there are some fish which he called as the prey fish, and then there's another species which he called as a predator. And what he observed was that there was a change in the predator to prey population during the World War time, and it was totally different from what happened before and after the war. Now, what happened actually during the war was that the fishermen had to abandon their fishing and they had to go and fight the war for the country. Now, what happened was that it resulted in a certain kind of advantage to the prey or the predator species, depending on whether the observations were done before and after the war or during the wartime. So this was actually explained very nicely using a similar analysis that we find in the Volterra prey predator equation system. So he formulated this hypothesis that during the war, the predator prey community was close to its natural state of relatively high proportion of predator fish, while the more intensive fishing of the pre and post war years disturbed that equilibrium due to the advantage of prey species. But he was unable to give a biological reason for this, and he turned to the Italian mathematician by name Vito Volterra. So the second equation, y dash is equal to minus c plus dx y, you also add this term minus hy, where h is the harvesting coefficient to represent the fact that the predator fish are also going to be killed during the process of fishing. So this h, of course, as I mentioned, is a positive constant. So now during the fishing, the differential equations are going to have this new form, and the equilibrium position inside the population quadrant will now be shifted from the original location of c by d a by b to a new position that is given by c plus h by d and a minus h by b respectively. How do I go to the next slide, sir? There is something that is asking me to annotate.
So, are you in annotating? Yeah.
Okay. So, of course, this A is to be assumed to be greater than H, otherwise the average population size of the harvested predator is not going to be a positive number. So in order to explain Ancona's observations, what we do is we look at the predator fraction of the total average catch in a day. That is, since in the absence of harvesting, that is in the absence of fishing, the predator fraction of the total average catch will be given by A by B upon A by B plus C by D. But if there is harvesting, then it will change to the expression that you will find here. Okay. So the predator fraction of the total average catch will then be AD minus DH upon AD plus BC plus H times B minus D in the presence of harvesting. Now, if I take H to be a variable and if I differentiate this predator fraction with respect to H, we will find an expression whose value is actually negative. That means what? It means that this quantity should decrease as H increases, which is to say that the predator population is going to decline in the presence of harvesting. So this analysis shows that a fraction of prey will increase with an increasing in the harvesting rate, just as we have been able to show that the fraction of predator will decrease with an increasing in the harvesting rate. So this has answered Ankona's question, that is, the predator population dropped, the predator population increases with a drop in fishing during the World War and it declines when the fishing resumes, which is before and after the war. So this is something that he was able to explain mathematically. Now, one dramatic confirmation of the validity of this principle occurred when an insecticide, that is DDT, was applied to control a certain pest. So I'm going to talk about this insect called the quaternary cushion scale insect, which infested some American citrus orchards. Now, this was actually accidentally introduced, and its predator is called as a ladybird beetle from Australia. Now, in order to control this quaternary cushion scale insect, this ladybird beetles would have been very useful. However, there was a pesticide, DDT, that was sprayed on these orchards, and what happened had actually the adverse effect which people did not anticipate. While they actually wanted this quaternary cushion scale insect to decrease in numbers by spraying DDT, they observed that their population actually increased. Now, why did this happen? Is because of the same reason that the prey population increased during the time of fishing in the previous example. So what actually happened was this DDT acted indiscriminately. It killed all insects. That means it killed both the insects, the quaternary cushion scale insect as well as the ladybird beetles. So the ladybird beetles were the predators and this quaternary cushion scale insect were the prey. And in the because of the widespread use of DDT, the number of ladybirds, that is the population of the ladybirds, drastically dropped. So what happened was the original insects, they were freed of this predation, and therefore their populations increased. So this actually is a reason that we now have a more cautious approach to the use of pesticides such as DDT. So we studied an interesting nonlinear system that occurs in population dynamics, which models a particular kind of interaction between two species. This work of Vito Volterra, it enriched both mathematicians as well as biologists. Now, as other kinds of models where there are similar species, instead of having a species like prey and predator, we can have two species which compete for the same resources. So these kind of models actually have been used to study other types of competitive situations. For instance, you may use them to study businesses competing for the same market. That is, see, if you have a closed environment, let's say there are two species of fish and they are competing for a limited supply of food. And they may not prey on each other, but they do compete for the available food. So suppose I call X and Y to be the populations of the two species at time t, then we assume that the population of each species in the absence of other is governed by a logistic equation. See, it's not practical to assume that there will be an exponential growth or decay of population. So actually the population of a species is governed by what is called as a logistic equation. So for example, for the population X, you will see not just some constant times X, but some constant times x minus another constant times x square. So this is actually what is called as a logistic equation. So here for population y, I have a similar logistic equation. So epsilon 1, epsilon 2 are the growth rates of the two populations, and this epsilon 1 upon sigma 1, epsilon 2 upon sigma 2, these are their saturation levels. So again, you'll see that these are nonlinear equations, but they are different from the previous prey-predator type of equations. And when both species are present, what will happen is each will tend to diminish the available food supply for the other. That means they reduce each other's growth rates and saturation populations. Now, if see the first equations, this is the equation for the growth rate of X in the absence of Y. Similarly, the second one is the growth rate of Y in the absence of X. Now, when both the populations are present, we actually have to change these equations by taking into account the role of X and Y in each other's population. And therefore, we will be modeling this situation by a system of equations as given here in 10. That is, here I'll use a different constant alpha 1 here. And so I add this term minus alpha 1 XY. So similarly, for the growth rate of Y, I will add this term minus alpha 2 XY. And these values of these constants epsilon 1, epsilon 2, sigma 1, sigma 2, alpha 1, alpha 2, these actually will depend on the particular species under consideration. And in general, they must be determined from the observations. Like, for example, there may be two business houses and they'll be competing for the same market. They may launch a product, the same kind of product, and they may be competing for the same. They may be competing in the same geographical region. So these constants that we have are certain parameters which will depend on the geographical area and so many other parameters like that. So as I was mentioning here, for the COVID situation, for instance, the models like SIR, SEIR, etc., they have been used. And I actually personally know of a particular situation where this study was very useful. So there was this NGO that was trying to provide the PPEs to certain hospitals and old age homes and so on. And they had to estimate how many PPEs, you know, these masks, ventilators, etc., would be required in a certain location. So so if they have to work out these logistics, they actually had, they needed some model based on which they can estimate. So it's not very as simple as what I'm actually explaining to you, like the SIR model. A lot of data mining and other things had to be done. There was a group of mathematicians, statisticians, and data scientists who were working on this. But then it helped them to make a predictive model that helped them to predict 4 days in advance about what would be the number of susceptible people, number of infected people, the number of exposed, reduced number of people in the population from this disease and so on. So these are the kind of studies that would be very, very important. And in fact, if there are more parameters, you may actually have to use partial differential equations. So there, of course, there are so many other models like this in population dynamics. I cannot cover all of them, but you can find them. There's a very nice book, if you want to see the elementary book, where you can find some discussion of these kind of population models, is the differential equations by Y.S.D. Prema. And of course, the first one that I did for the population of foxes and rabbits was a topic covered in the differential equations book by George F. Simmons. So what actually the reason for presenting these examples is to show you how a wealth of information can be actually obtained from the differential equations without actually solving them. And the actual models, as I said, may involve nonlinear partial differential equations. And you may actually have to, if you really are interested in the solution rather than in the nature of the solution, you'll have to go for the numerics. So here are some references. You can have a look at some of these books. And if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer.